Tathaya pratibodhitam bhagavata narayanena svayam vyasena gratitam purana munina madhye mahabharatam advaitam britavarshinim bhagavati ashtadashadhyayinim ambatvam anusandadhami bhagavad-gite bhavadveshinim namostute vyasa vishala buddhe pullaravindaya tapatna netra yena tvaya bharata taila purna prajvalito jnana maya pradipaha prapanna parijataya totra vetraika panaye jnana mudraya krishnaya gita mrita duhe namaha sarvopanishado gavo dogdha gopalanandanaha partho vatsa sudhir bhokta dugdham gitamritam mahat vasudeva sutam devam kamsachanuramardhanam Devaki paramanandam krishnam vande jagad gurum Bhishma drona tata jaya trata jala gandhara nilotpala Shalya grahavati kripena vahani karnena velakula Ashvatthama vikarna gora makara duryodhana vartini Sotirna kalupandavaira nanadikkai vartaka keshavaha Parashalya vachasaroja mamalam gitartha gandhotkatam Nanakhyanaka kesaram harikatha sambodhana bodhitam Loke sajjana shatpadaira harahappe piyamana muda Bhuyad bharata pankajam kalimala pradvamsina shreyase Mukam karoti vachalam pangum langhayate girim Yat kripatam aham vande paramananda madhavam Yam brahma varunendra rudra marutas tunvanti divyairstavaihi Vedai sanga padakramo panishadai gayanti yamsamagaha Dhyana vastita tadgatena manasappashyanti yam yogino Yasyaddham navidusura suragana devaya tasmai namaha Om Mangalam Sadhu Veshaya Shishya Chitta Vilasine Vidita Akhila Vedyaya Moksha Vigna Vighatine Saumya Kashi Nivasaya Deshikaya Viragine Chaitanya Nanda Rupaya Jivan Muktaya Mangalam Om Sahana Vavatu Sahana Bhunaktu Saha Viryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 श्री सद्गुरुदेव महाराज की जय। गुड मॉर्निंग। Yesterday, we started to talk about Karma Yoga. We explained that Krishna teaches in the Bhagavad Gita about two paths. The path of knowledge, which he calls Sankhya, and the path of action, which he calls Yoga. The path of action, Yoga, is also called Karma Yoga. And we started to discuss what is the meaning of Karma Yoga, showing that Karma Yoga has to do with the intention and the understanding with which we do our actions. We made a distinction between Seva and Karma Yoga. Seva as service and Karma Yoga as a spiritual path that leads to liberation. In Karma Yoga, we relinquish the identification with the body and the mind. When the action is taking place, we recognize, realize that I am not the doer. I am not the one who is doing the actions. And I am not the enjoyer. I am not the one who have the experiences. I am just the witnessing consciousness, which is aware of the body and the mind in action. When we do actions in Karma Yoga, we do it without expectation for any reward. We don't do it because of what we are going to get out of it. Then why do we do actions? We do actions simply because it is the right thing to do. So if we see somebody in a need for help, we just do it because somebody needs help. We don't do it because we want to feel good with ourselves. We don't do it because we want to get a reward. We don't do it because we are trained to do it or whatever. We do it just because it is the right thing to do, and we do it for this reason. We don't expect anything to come back in result, not even a thank you. And in Karma Yoga also we have different bhavanas, as we described yesterday. Yesterday we mentioned three bhavanas. One is Deva Bhava, which means seeing the Lord in the other. When I serve someone, either a person, an animal, whatever, I see God in the other person, in the other. The second bhava is called Atma Bhava, in which we see our own self in the other person. And then we mentioned also Sakshi Bhava, which means remaining as the witness, just an observant witness of all the actions unfolding. This is what Karma Yoga is all about. And therefore you can see that even going to the office on Monday can become Karma Yoga. If I go to my work and I do it with detachment, without any attachment, without any expectation for reward, if while I do it, I realize that I am not the doer, I'm just the witnessing consciousness, I'm not the enjoyer, I realize it directly, And then also the service, whatever I do it with one of these bhavas, then it also becomes karma yoga. You know? Is it okay to get salary, to get payment for karma yoga? Yeah, there's no problem with getting payment because you don't do it for the sake of the payment. In order to live in this world, you need to have a job. You have people depending on you. You have children and wife or husband. And you simply need to bring some money home to protect them, to serve them. That is also karma yoga if it is done in the right manner. You see? So karma yoga is not volunteering. Volunteering is seva. Karma yoga can be in the form of volunteering. It can be also in the form of doing my daily work, my daily routine. But with the proper intention, with the proper understanding. We do service, seva, we do volunteer work as a practice. Because as you may already recognize, it is not easy to do karma yoga. Right? It is easy to say karma yoga, but to do it with all these intentions and understanding is very difficult. Actually, only a realized yogi can do a real and complete karma yoga. Because we keep forgetting that we are not the doer, we keep forgetting we are not the enjoyer. We always look for something to get out of what we are doing, at least somebody should say thank you for what we do, right? So really to do karma yoga is not easy. Therefore, we practice. And the practice is in the form of service. We go and volunteer, or we go and help people where they don't even know we are helping them. Or we do things and we try to work on these attitudes. But ultimately, we should be able to bring karma yoga into our daily activity, into every action we do. Karma yoga should go with us throughout the day. Okay? So this is a little bit regarding karma yoga. Now, verse 47 is a very famous verse. Let us chant it together. This is the most famous verse in regard to karma yoga. Karmanyeva adhikaraste Maphaleshu kadachana Makarma phalahetubhur Mate sangostva akarmani karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phalahetubhur mate sangostva karmani. Karmani eva adhikaraha te. Krishna tells Arjuna, you have the right only for the work. Ma phaleshu kadachana, but never you have the right for the fruits of the action. In other words, Krishna tells Arjuna, you should perform actions. You should do, you should not sit quiet. You should be engaged in action, but never expect anything in return. This is the heart of karma yoga. You do without any expectation for a reward. Ma karma palahe turbhur, ma te sangaha astu akarmani. Says, how to do it? Ma karma palahe turbhur, one should not expect the reward of action, but ma te sangostu akarmani, one should not also go towards inactions. What happens, a person is doing, he may say, okay, Krishna tells me not to expect the fruit of the action. So what's the point? Let me go to sleep and just relax a little bit. Anyway, I'm not getting any result, right? So we just relax. So he says, no, you should act. You should be engaged in action, in karma yoga. We constantly serve, we constantly walk, we constantly do actions in the right intention. Just giving up action and stop doing things is not, it's not the renunciation that Krishna is teaching in the Gita. So this is what this verse is saying. Thy right it is to walk only, but never with its fruits. Let not the fruit of action be thy motive, nor let thy attachment be to inaction. Okay? And then in the next verse, Krishna is giving a definition of yoga, the first definition of yoga. He says, Yoga stak kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya siddhya siddhyo samobhutva samatvam yoga uchyate. What is the definition of yoga? Samatvam. Samatvam yoga uchyate. Yoga is evenness of mind. Yoga is the capacity to keep the mind calm, peaceful, and even without any disturbance. In the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, he describes yoga as chitta vritti nirodha. Right? It is the cessation of the chitta vrittis, of the mental waves. But here, the definition is samatvam, peacefulness, evenness of mind, the capacity to keep the mind completely even and peaceful is called yoga. And then he gives a second definition of yoga in verse 50. Buddhi yukto jahatiha ubhe sukrita duskrite tasmat yogaya yudyasva yoga karma sukaushalam. What is yoga? Yoga karma sukaushalam. Yoga is skill in action. Karmasu means in action. And kaushalam means skill. Krishna says, what is yoga? Yoga is skill in action. Yoga here refers to karma yoga. What is the meaning skill in action? Does it mean that if you do something very skillfully, it becomes yoga? Sometimes you can do very skillfully harm other people. Does it mean it is yoga? No. What is the meaning of being skillful? What is the meaning of doing action in a skillful way? The answer is that doing actions skillfully means to do actions, to act in such a way that will not be binding. Normally, our actions are binding us. Why? Because of the law of karma. We didn't speak yet about the law of karma, and we are going to speak about it soon. The law of karma says that every action we do is producing a reaction. And this production of a reaction is binding. Is going because we have to experience the results of all of our actions. We perpetuate our what we call our reincarnations. We have to come back again and again and again and again, and we are caught in a wheel of birth and death. This is the way it is explained, which we call samsara. When we do actions as karma yoga, these actions do not produce a result, or it produces a result which is not binding, in opposing to the other actions, right? A person who does negative actions, harming or hurting other person, is going to get what we call a bad karma. A person who is helping another person who is doing what we call good actions is going to get a positive karma, which will give him a lot of enjoyment. But both of these are still binding because they are causing us to come back again and again and again and again. And they are preventing us from realizing our true nature. But karma yoga are actions which are done to this understanding that I am not the doer, I am not the enjoyer, etc. All those things that we discussed regarding karma yoga. And therefore, these actions are not producing karma. They are not producing binding karma. And therefore, they are liberating. They are not karmas which are binding. So when Krishna says, Yoga karmasu kaushalam. When Krishna says that yoga is skill in action, he means that you perform the actions in such a way that it will not be binding. On the other hand, it will be conducive for your liberation. Okay? So, now, Now I want to jump a little bit to the beginning of the third chapter. Verse 1, we can chant it together, chapter 3. Arjuna uvacha,
Arjuna uvacha,
jayasi,
jayasi,
chet karmanaste,
chet karmanaste,
mata buddhir,
mata buddhir,
janardana,
janardana,
tat kim karmani
tatkim karmani
gorema
gorema
niyojayasi
niyojayasi
keshava
keshava
arjuna uvacha jayasi chet karmanaste mata buddhir janardana Tat kim karmani gorema miyo jayasi keshava. Arjuna said, now Arjuna has a question. Jayasi chet karmanaha te mata buddhir janardana. Ho janardana, ho Krishna. You are telling me you are considering knowledge, buddhi, you are considering knowledge to be superior. Tat kim karmani goremam, but still you are asking me to engage in action. Arjuna is telling Krishna, Krishna, you are confusing me. You are telling me that knowledge is superior to action. Remember, Krishna was talking about the two paths. He says, you are telling me that yoga is superior to action, but then you are asking me to do action. Why are you asking me to do that which is inferior? Arjuna says, Krishna, I also want to go in the superior path. Why are you asking me to go in the inferior path? Where he was asking him? This is in verse 49. In verse 49, Krishna was saying, far lower than the yoga of wisdom is action, O Arjuna. Seek thou refuge in wisdom. Wretched they whose motive is the foot. In verse 49, Krishna says that the yoga of knowledge is much superior to the yoga of action. And therefore, Arjuna is asking Krishna, if you say it is so much superior, why do you ask me to go in the inferior? Right? We also like Krishna. We always want the best thing, the superior. We want to have the best. And Arjuna is asking Krishna, why are you asking me to do that? With this apparently perplexing speech, thou confusest, as it were, my understanding. Therefore, tell me that one way for certain by which I may attain bliss. Arjuna says, please tell me the one thing which is the right thing for me. Actually, when Krishna said in verse 49 that he was talking about the yoga of wisdom and action, the yoga of wisdom here means samatvam, means this evenness of mind. That's how Shankaracharya explained. Arjuna misunderstood it, but because of that he was asking this question. You talk about two paths. I want to take the better one. Why you are asking me to take the other one? And Krishna answers in chapter 3, verse 3, in this world there is a twofold path, as I said before, O sinless one, the path of knowledge of the Sankhyas and the path of action of the yogis. Now we have to understand really what are these two paths, what is the difference between them. What is the meaning of them? The path of knowledge is a path of direct realization which comes along with renunciation. This is the path of knowledge that Krishna teaches in the Gita. This is called the direct path. It is direct because it is immediate and it doesn't involve any action. It is not something you do. And that's why it is also difficult. Because we are people of actions. We want to do things. We want to engage in action. The path of knowledge has no action in it. It is not something you do. It is actually realization of the truth that is coming along with renunciation of all of our attachments, of all of our preconceived notions, of all of our conditionings. Renunciation is not a form of action? No. I will demonstrate it. I will tell you a story, a classical story that demonstrates this point. It is called Dashamurkhanyaya. It is the analogy of the 10 fools. There was a group of 10 people going on a picnic on Sunday morning in some place. And on the way, they had to cross the river, and there was no bridge. So they swam across the river. When they reached the other bank, the leader put everybody in one line to count them, to make sure that everybody made it to the other side. So he counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Somebody is missing. Again, he counts from the other side. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Then he asks somebody else to count. He goes, stands in the line, and the other one counts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now somebody is missing, they know. They are very worried, they cry, they go back to the river and they start to search for the missing person. And they are not able to find anybody. They go down the river and up, and they are in a lot of distress. After some time, a yogi is passing by, and he sees these 10 people going up and down, crying, wailing. He asks, "Guys, what is going on?" They say, "Listen, we were 10 friends, we swam across, we are not able to find our missing person, blah, blah, blah." He looks around and he says, "I can help you find your friend." "Really, where is he? Did you see him?" He says, "Don't worry, come, call everybody here, put them in one line, and you stand in the last one." He put the leader last one. He puts all of them in one line, and then he counts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then he comes to the leader and he says, "You are the missing person. You didn't count yourself." And the leader, "Ah, I am the 10th person. Nobody was ever missing, right?" This is the analogy. Of course, we are this 10th person. We are searching for our true nature. We look everywhere. Where have I lost myself? Maybe I will find it in another person. Maybe I will find it in a child. Maybe I will find it in possessions. Maybe I will find it. We are looking for our true nature outside. And then the yogi comes and tells us, "You are that bliss that you are searching for." Right? Now, how many actions, how much searching did that person had to do in order to realize he is the 10th person? The answer is none. It's not about searching. No matter what he will do, he will not find the 10th person. All he needs to do is to give up the false notion that somebody is missing. Renunciation is to renounce this idea somebody is missing. It's not an action. He didn't need to go anywhere. He didn't need to do anything. The moment the truth was presented, the 10th person was found. The idea somebody is missing was renounced. It is not something you do. It is not an action. Renunciation is not something you do. Going up and down the river and searching for a missing person is an action. As a matter of fact, Vedanta philosophy says that actions cannot really lead to liberation. Why? Because action is based on ignorance. Action is based on duality. What is duality? We said that the truth, that ultimate reality is one. There is only one self. And that is the ground of all being, of everything. There is one reality, which is the self. There is no other reality. There's not the self plus the world, the self plus God, the self plus whatever. There is only the self. That is the only reality. This is the conclusion of the Vedanta philosophy. It is called non-dualistic philosophy. But actions are based on ignorance. Actions are based on, this is me, and I am doing an action towards you. So how something which is based on ignorance can destroy ignorance? Right? How actions which are based on ignorance have the capacity to destroy ignorance? It is like trying to extinguish fire with a burner. You cannot. If you try to extinguish fire with a burner, you just increase the fire. In the same way, action is not capable of bringing liberation. Because liberation is knowledge. Liberation is the end of ignorance. Is realizing I am the tenth person. This is liberation. Liberation is not something I do, is not something I possessed. This is a very common mistake that people say, I want to get enlightenment. I want to get self-realization. There is no such a thing as getting. It is just like that person wants to find the tenth person. You cannot find the tenth person. Because the tenth person is not missing. You just have to realize that nobody is missing. In the same manner, we don't need to get self-realization. Self-realization is not something you find in the supermarket and you buy it. It's not something you possess. Why? Because if it was so, something you possess, you're also going to lose. Realization is to realize I am that peace, that happiness that I'm searching for. This is my own self. To really realize it directly. So the path of knowledge that Krishna is talking about in the Bhagavad Gita as Sankhya is the path of this direct realization. Realizing I am that pure consciousness. And the giving up of all the false ideas, the false notions that are associated with our ignorance. In that path, there is no place for any action. It is not something you do. And therefore, it is difficult. Because so often, when I talk about it, people say, okay, I want that. This is what I want. Tell me, what should I do? No, it's not something you do. There is no action. Therefore, Lord Krishna is giving us the second path, the path of action. If action is not leading to liberation, then why to do action? Right? We just said that action cannot lead to liberation. Then what about meditation? Is not meditation an action? Yes, meditation is an action. Can meditation lead me to liberation? No, it cannot. What about asanas, pranayama, service, karma yoga? Can they lead me to liberation? No, they are actions. Actions are based on ignorance. Ignorance cannot destroy ignorance. So actions are not directly leading to liberation. Not even meditation, not even pranayama, asanas, karma yoga. None of this is directly leading you to liberation. It cannot. It is an action. An action is based on ignorance. Then why do we do it? Why Krishna is teaching it in the Gita? The answer is that the path of yoga, what Krishna calls yoga, the path of action, is actually the path of purification. Our minds are so impure. There are so many impurities in our minds. And a mind which is full of impurity is not capable of realization. A mind which is full of impurity is an obstacle. Therefore, before we are able to approach the direct path, the path of realization, before we are able to have this realization, which comes with renunciation, which is the direct path, we have first to engage in purification. We have to purify our mind, we have to purify our heart. And this is done through actions. What actions? All the actions that we have discussed. Meditation, pranayama, asanas, service, etc., etc. Devotions. All these rituals, all these actions that we do are done for the sake of purification of the mind. This is the message of the Bhagavad Gita. First, you have to purify the mind. There are rare cases of people who can go directly to the direct path, to Sankhya. They don't need, they already, their mind is already completely pure by a lot of sadhana they did in their previous lives. And in this time, they don't need it. They just need this direct realization. A good example we have in our times is Ramana Maharshi, who lived in the last century. He didn't need all this karma yoga, meditation, pranayama, etc. For him, realization was spontaneous. He just realized. But for everybody else, we need first to purify our mind, to purify our heart, and this is done through yoga. This is done through the path of action. Okay? So all of our practices are meant to purify our mind, to purify our heart. This is very important to understand.
Is there any realized person today?
Of course. There must be. There are always some realized persons in the world. How are you going to decide who is realized and who is not? Swamiji, my teacher, used to say, in order to know if somebody is a doctor, you have to be a doctor yourself. In the same way, he says, if you want to know if somebody is realized, you have to be realized yourself. But at the same time, you say, yes, at all times there are realized people in the world. Sometimes they are not famous, they are not exposed, but there are. Why not? There should be. Okay. So, this is a little bit about this. Okay. In verse 27 of chapter 3, page 70.
Could you say it again?
Verse 27, chapter 3, page 70. All actions are wrought in all cases by the qualities of nature only. He whose mind is deluded by egoism think, I am the doer. Here we get into the discussion of the three gunas. And I want to explain because the Bhagavad Gita is dealing a lot with the three gunas. And then we will see what Krishna is saying. Many of you have heard already about the three gunas and some of you have not, so I'm going to explain it. According to the Vedanta tradition, this whole world is made of three principles, three qualities, which in Sanskrit are called gunas. Guna means a quality. So there are three main qualities that are responsible for the entire universe. They are called in Sanskrit sattva, rajas, and tamas. These are the three, sattva, rajas, and tamas. Sattva is the principle of purity, goodness. It is also information, intelligence. Okay? Rajas is the quality of activity, restlessness, energy, power. And tamas is the quality of inertia, darkness, matter. We see these three everywhere in the universe. When we look in the external world, they manifest in the form of information, energy, and matter. Right? When we learn physics, we come to see that the whole universe, we find these three principles. We find matter, right? This book is made of material, made of paper, right? And then there is some energy in it, right? It has, for example, it has the gravity, gravitational force working on it. So this is a form of energy. And then there is information. There is some, it has a shape, particular shape, particular form. And all this is the principle of information. So we see that everything in nature has these three gunas. Sattva, rajas, and tamas. Information, energy, and matter. Then also we see the three gunas working in the mental world. In the mental world also, we see these three gunas active. For example, in the mind, we see thoughts which are very active, restless. For example, emotions like anger are manifestation of rajas, of the rajoguna, right? We have in the mind thoughts which are very peaceful, benevolent, bright, clear, pure. This is manifestation of sattva. And we also sometimes have very, what we call tamasic thoughts. When the mind is very dull, depressed, sad, deluded, sleepy. These are all forms of tamasic states. We see these three gunas everywhere in the universe. They are actually the whole universe is made of the three gunas. In the Vedanta philosophy, they have this idea of the evolution of Prakriti. Prakriti is the primordial nature. The primordial nature means the basis of all the manifestation. This Prakriti, or this primordial nature, is made of the three gunas. They say the three gunas are like the three strands of the rope, which is called Prakriti. So everywhere we look, all we see is different manifestations of the three gunas. This is the idea. This is how it is described. In every object in the universe, all the three gunas are present. Only their combination is different. So when the three gunas manifest in a particular way, they become a microphone. When they manifest in a different way, the three gunas become a book. It is all just these three gunas interact with each other. And the three gunas are always in flux, always in change. They are never stable. Sometimes sattva is dominant, sometimes rajas is dominant, sometimes tamas is dominant. They keep changing all the time. And this is causing the manifestation of the universe. As a matter of fact, in the Vedic cosmology, the world is going into cycles. And between two cycles, the world goes into an unmanifested state. There is like before the Big Bang, what was there? There was an unmanifested. This is how at least the Vedanta is calling it, the unmanifested state. At that time, the three gunas are in equilibrium. This is the way it is described in pralaya, in dissolution. The three gunas are in equilibrium. There is no any movement in them. And then, suddenly, there is a movement in the three gunas. And that movement generates creation. This is how it is described in Vedanta. And so creation is nothing but the movements of the three gunas. I will give you an analogy that will help you to visualize it. Think about the movie theater. In the past, there used to be projectors in the movie theater that had three lights. You remember? There was red light, blue light, and yellow. Correct? These are the basic colors. Am I correct? Red, blue, and yellow. With them, all the range of colors can be produced. And these lights were projected in a particular way on a screen, and that created a movie. That created a whole drama. Right? The screen is like Brahman. Brahman we didn't discuss yet. We have to explain it. But Brahman means the self. Okay? We'll put it now in a simple way. Later on we will explain more. But the self, which is the ground of being, as we discussed, the self which is the basis of all this reality, which is the only reality, is like the screen. Okay? And on this screen, there is a projection of what we call reality, right? We said that I don't have a cup in my hand, right? It is just a glass, and it is not glass, it is just sand. And we just, when we break it down, ultimately we get to consciousness. Consciousness is the ground of everything, is the basis of all reality. And everything else is superimposed over it. You understand? So that reality, which is the ground of all being, is like the screen. And on this screen, there is a projection that creates the manifestation of all this world. All this world appears within consciousness. But how it appears? It appears to these three gunas. Just as in the movie, there are three lights that project different combinations of lights on the screen and creates the illusion of a drama. You sit in the movie theater and you see just different lights displaying on the screen, and then you cry, you laugh, you have all kinds of emotions, and all kinds of stuff is going on. Well, actually, all you see is just pieces of light displaying on a screen. You never see a river on the screen. You never see people on the screen, flowers, skies. You don't see that. All you see is these three lights displaying on the screen. But you forget it and you take it for reality. You take it for something really that is taking place. And therefore, you react to it. Right? This is what happens in the movie theater. In a little bit similar way, we say that the three gunas are like the three lights. They are projecting this reality over pure consciousness. Pure consciousness is like the screen, and the three gunas are projecting the whole universe on it. So the three gunas are really the basis of this reality. Okay? We will talk more about the three gunas later on, but this is like just the introduction of this topic of the three gunas. Later on, Krishna is talking a lot about it in the Gita. Okay, we will stop now. Sit quiet for a moment.
Shri Sadgurudev Maharaj ki jai.